Nobel Prize-winning economist Simon Kuznets is said to have remarked in the early 1970s that there are four types of economies in the world: developed, underdeveloped, Japan, and Argentina.
This long series of economic crises has made Argentina the only nation in modern history to regress to developing country status.
A very important fact here: when Juan Domingo Perón came to government, Argentina was one of the 10 most prosperous and richest economies in the world.
Y esa mezcla de despotismo, corrupción personal y demagogia tercermundista convirtió a Argentina de país rico en país pobre, donde se ha quedado.
La República Argentina fue una de las más ricas de América, después de Estados Unidos la más rica, en muchos aspectos incluso más avanzada que Estados Unidos y desde luego una de las más ricas del mundo.
Argentina was once one of the richest countries in the world. By 1910, its trade amounted to 7% of the global total, making it the so-called breadbasket of the world.
The country was even an international creditor. Countries like the United Kingdom actually owed it money.
A century ago, Argentina was one of the 10 richest countries in the world. But it has earned the dubious distinction of being the only nation ever to regress to developing country status.
A comienzos del siglo XX, Argentina fue uno de los países más ricos del mundo. Sus habitantes eran más ricos que los franceses o que los alemanes.
A pesar de la crisis del 29, continuaba siendo uno de los 10 países más ricos del mundo.
Pues se decía en Italia, había un dicho célebre, decía: «Sei rico como un argentino». Eres rico como un argentino porque los argentinos eran ricos. Todos eran ricos.
En aquel momento, el sistema político y las instituciones argentinas, como el derecho de propiedad o la libertad de comercio, animaban a los inversores a invertir su dinero en la Argentina.
En aquellos años, Argentina era uno de los principales receptores de inversión directa europea.
Well, up until about the 1930s, Argentina was one of the wealthiest countries in the world. Indeed, it was in the top 10. And its downfall began in the 1930s with a import substitution program, the rise of Peronism, the power of the trade unions, and big spending, and with that, big debt. I took on very big debt.
Argentino, nos anos 20, 30, era sinônimo de milionário na Europa. A alfabetização da Argentina era de 100%. Até que chegou o Perón e acabou com o país, né, com a ajuda dos demais peronistas.
While its competitor, the United States, tackled the problem with programs like the New Deal, Argentina was paralyzed and began to move toward nationalism and protectionist policies.
Y esa mezcla de despotismo, corrupción personal y demagogia tercermundista convirtió a Argentina de país rico en país pobre, donde se ha quedado.
It has had a total of 21 IMF programs since 1958, which must be an all-time record. Given that many programs last 3 years, that's are often truncated in the case of Argentina, because it simply can't meet its obligations to the fund, its performance criteria.
So how can a country suffer such a dramatic decline? Well, it might have something to do with the fact that since, roughly speaking, the 1940s, Argentina has known only two political movements: military and Peronism.
Perón era un agregado militar en Italia, en la Italia de Mussolini. Entonces ahí se hizo fascista, que significa que el Estado manda en la vida de los individuos para asegurarse de nuestra felicidad.
A group of high-level officers conspire to install a government modeled after Mussolini's Italian fascist regime. Calling themselves the Group of United Officers, they successfully took power in 1943. Among their members was a little-known army colonel named Juan Domingo Perón.
Juan Domingo Perón, who was sent to Italy, a country where he met and studied firsthand how Benito Mussolini's government was organized. And you know what? Soon after, he'd get the chance to put this knowledge right into practice.
Take what he called a social democratic project, based on what he saw in Europe, including in fascist Italy. Yeah. And apply it to the unique circumstances of Argentina.
Pero el gobernante que llega, ¿no es cierto?, sobre todo en el caso del socialismo del siglo XXI, por la vía democrática al poder, dice ser el pueblo, dice fusionarse con el pueblo. Y divide, obviamente, hay un antipueblo, que son las oligarquías y los que son los siervos de la oligarquía, la casta, todo eso. Entonces divide, aquí están los explotadores y supuestamente ellos representan a las grandes mayorías oprimidas. La visión de democracia que hay detrás, y esto es súper importante entenderlo, la visión de democracia que hay detrás es una visión puramente instrumental y litúrgica de democracia. La democracia entendida como un mecanismo netamente electivo y que una vez que la persona, el caudillo, el grupo, llega al poder, no tiene ningún límite, porque en vista de que limitar su poder es limitar al pueblo es antidemocrático. ¿Se entiende la lógica?
In practice, he transformed Argentina into a kind of army under the command of a single leader, its president.
His primary goals were to remove British influence in the economy, to industrialize the nation, and to decrease inequality. Now, to be fair to Perón, he did succeed in his aims. At first, and Argentina had a five-year economic boom. However, this didn't last, and Perón's popularity declined as economic woes returned to Argentina. This was mostly due to the fact that he nationalized everything owned by foreigners, which scared off investors because nobody likes having their stuff taken.
While the US and Europe lowered the barriers to trade, Argentina sought industrialization within its borders. Unfortunately, that wasn't enough to kickstart its economy.
For what it's worth, this tactic of nationalize everything that was owned by foreigners and pumping money into building out industry did sort of work for a while. But once other nations had recovered from the Second World War, they were very cranky that all of their foreign assets had been stolen. To add insult to injury, Argentina was more than happy to extend an open invitation to German Nazis that the world had just fought so hard to defeat. For this reason, nobody wanted to invest in Argentina or buy any of the stuff that they were making in their fancy new factories, and for a nation that was heavily dependent on exports and foreign investment, this was a major blow.
Thus, Perón managed to nationalize a lot of companies, especially those related to public services such as transport, energy, and communications. He also placed banking under governmental control and approved a lot of foreign trade restrictions.
When Argentina brought in protectionist policies, it lacked a mature enough industrialized base to sustain itself. Argentina's incomplete post-war industrialization, dependent on foreign inputs and capital goods.
And he also achieved a lot of popular support. So how did he do it? Well, he did it by maintaining utility rates even below their cost and hiring a lot of employees for the government and for governmental companies. And it's certainly not so much of a coincidence that the Kirchners 60 years later did practically the same thing. Of course, all of this involved a lot of spending. And, well, how do you think he financed it? Of course, he started printing money.
A portion of voters believed rich elites were corrupt and not particularly productive. Populism and political instability ensued, and private investment suffered.
Take a bit of the blame? Well, no, he didn't at all. In fact, he blamed alleged speculators of attacking the national economy. And to remedy all of this, he multiplied the government controls, regulated prices, and implemented all kinds of measures that would even affect bread distribution.
Durante los 10 años que duró su gobierno, las distorsiones creadas por el Estado sobre la actividad económica fueron tan grandes que los argentinos llegaron a tener que comer pan negro y racionar su consumo de carne.
Por escasez, los productores argentinos preferían dejar de producir antes que cumplir con los controles de precios o tipos de cambio que estableció el gobierno. El gasto público, los altos impuestos y la inflación habían llegado a Argentina para quedarse. Argentina es uno de los pocos países del mundo donde la pobreza crece en lugar de disminuir.
En otras palabras, el nuevo modelo implantado por Juan Domingo Perón se convirtió en algo así como una máquina de fabricar pobreza. Por supuesto, todo bajo un enorme culto al líder y también a su esposa, a Evita Perón.
Y Evita, que es el modelo de toda persona que, no siendo nada, se pega a un líder y luego, a base de demagogia, pues tiene su aquel. Y la gente le toma cariño y tal. Y entonces ella, que era una cabaretera, bueno, una mujer, digamos, de alcance, entonces el guapo Perón se dedicaba a lo suyo, que eran las jovencitas, y entonces Evita se dedicaba a los pobres, que por supuesto siguieron siendo pobres. A mí lo que me gusta de Evita es que, como venía del hampa, del barro, del fango, se vestía y decía: yo me visto para mis pobres, me pongo mis joyas para mis pobres. Y los pobres lo agradecían. Y dice: hombre, para ir mal ya estamos nosotros. Es decir, tenía un sentido de la comunicación extraordinario, pero siempre que los pobres siguieran siendo pobres.
Perón's populism, though, also had its authoritarian side. He and his allies set about purging Argentine politics and society of anyone who opposed Perón, whether they were independent-minded labor leaders or newspaper publishers. Political parties other than the Peronist Party were harassed and repressed. Political corruption was endemic, as the Peróns surrounded themselves with relatives and friends, many of whom saw access to the Peróns as an invitation to seek personal and material gain. In many ways, Perón's authoritarianism resembled that of a modern-day caudillo.
What was at the cause of their decline, while other similar nations like Canada and Australia sailed on with their prosperity intact to this day? But perhaps the most compelling argument came from a 1992 paper published by a research team at the University of Madrid, which highlighted that property rights were the big thorn in the side of Argentina. Remember how the nation's assets kept on getting claimed by the state and then privatized and then claimed by the state and then privatized over and over again? Well, it turns out that that makes people really not want to invest in your country, which is really bad. But if investors look at Argentina, they're going to see all of this nationalizing business and be pretty scared to invest. If they do put their money into the nation, they are going to want higher returns and also going to want to have that money out quickly before some new government gets any idea. Today, Argentina might be facing a very different problem. A currency crisis. The most recent crisis was kicked off, as many have been before it, when it became obvious that Argentina would elect a new president that had a political stance that was more left-wing than his incumbent opposition.
A return of the left to power has set alarm bells ringing for international investors, with many concerned it could herald a new era of government intervention. The primaries on August 11th had a dramatic effect on Argentina's stock market, known as the Merval. It collapsed by 48% in dollar terms the very next day. The government has since restricted foreign currency purchases in an attempt to steady the ship, putting financial restrictions on companies as well as the country's citizens.
A day after the primary election took place, the Argentinian stock market plummeted by more than 48%, as investors feared they could be in for yet another round of nationalisation. The difference this time is that its currency had been thrown into jeopardy with no real plan to save it.
Because the government can't finance a significant budget deficit, Buenos Aires implements capital controls, it overvalues the domestic currency, it restricts imports, and a supplicant central bank prints pesos to paper over any cracks.
The government was increasing spending and discouraging exports, meaning it had to borrow more and more money to keep everything running. Gradually, what was once one of the world's most stable economies became one of the most volatile.
Argentina has had a major economic crisis roughly once every decade in the last half century. So hyperinflation, devaluations, and IMF bailouts have all become facts of life.
Si dejamos a un lado el caos de Venezuela, Argentina tiene la situación económica más frágil de la región. Y según la agencia Standard & Poor's, Argentina está entre los 5 países del mundo con la economía más frágil. Y es el segundo país en Latinoamérica, después de Venezuela, que genera menos confianza entre los inversionistas extranjeros.
Argentina ha desarrollado una política que podríamos decir de caradura cleptocrática, de jeta de acero en la política exterior, que consiste en ser dentro de casa lo más parecido a la policía de Stalin o de Mussolini o de Fidel Castro. Y fuera de casa, amigos de Fidel Castro y de Kim Il-sung y de Venezuela y de todo lo que sea antiamericano. Porque si los argentinos no son ricos como lo eran antes, la culpa nunca es de los argentinos, siempre es de los norteamericanos. Y si no, de los europeos.
And Argentina is a good example of how no country is too rich to fail.